please.
Okay, welcome to the Town of Hopkinton Planning Board meeting for Monday, September 12th, 2016. I'd like to give thanks to HCAM for coordinating the meeting. We are missing one member, and we'll have to watch to take care of the Mullen rule. And that's always very helpful. Agenda, we have three public hearings, of a variety of things. Scenic road hearing for removal of trees and stone wall on North Mill Street. Then an application for a minor site plan review for Golden Pond. And a continued public hearing for the Legacy Farms master plan special permit, talking about age-restricted housing. Let's see. I believe there's also under other announcements, there's a charter public hearing coming up. I'm trying to remember, it's coming up real quick. If anyone is interested in that, I guess look at the town website. I think it's in the next week or so. So just do a little public announcement on that. So,
what meeting was that for?
It was the charter.
Charter.
Charter review.
Charter review. I think it's next.
Next Monday, at 7 p.m.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like in the public forum. It's next Monday at 7 p.m.
I think it was listed in the independent.
So anyway, that made
us... Oh, at HCAM, sorry.
At HCAM Studios.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes it easy. Okay, I'm going to open the public hearing for 15 North Mill Street. This is a scenic road hearing. The applicant proposes to remove one 15-inch oak and one 10-inch cedar, as well as 20-foot of stone wall, which is within the public way of North Mill Street in order to widen the driveway. So, Dana, why don't you introduce yourself and explain what you want to do.
Sure. Dana Gonzalez, my husband and I are Gonzalez only property 15 North Mill. All we're really doing is looking to widen the footprint of the driveway. Right now it is very narrow. There's a number of oak trees and pine trees that line the driveway, making it very difficult to back in and out of it. Difficult if we have anybody over the house. So right now the driveway is actually gravel, so part of this is going to be paving, and before we can pave we need to get approval from the board to remove one particular tree. It's an oak tree around the corner of the driveway. Part of that is also expanding the existing opening of the stone wall. Right now it's approximately 16 wide, the opening of the end of the driveway. We're looking to make it about 20 feet. That's all included in the drawing as well. So we'll use the existing stones to rebuild other areas of stone wall that, you know, need some maintenance, and also to create an apron at the entrance of the driveway. There's a second tree that is referenced on the drawing as well. It's dead. I don't even honestly know what it is. That is within the stone wall. So part of the disruption of the what is referenced as 20 feet is removing that tree and again repurposing the stones to ensure the integrity of that stone wall.
First of all, the dead tree, we don't have jurisdiction over the dead ones. Okay. Dead ones are dead ones. You get that one. This is the parcel. That's an automatic hit.
Well, it's just the tree warden on the house.
The tree warden. The tree warden is the guy on dead trees. But we don't have jurisdiction with that. Okay, so I think everyone sees the plan that's there. What questions do members of the board have, if any?
Well, there was some objection ready.
Yep. I see one of the folks that wrote us the letter is here, so we'll get to them too.
But did we have any comments from the tree warden?
He went out and looked at it. He didn't have any comments. He was going to attend tonight, but once we received the objections, his role is then taking over by the Board of Selectmen. So he felt that the need for him tonight was not necessary, so he's not here. But he had no objections to the removal.
Other questions from members of the board? Just
I'm not sure if the question, Mr. Chair, or maybe a question, a discussion point. She mentioned that today it's 16 feet. You want to go to 20. What are the surrounding houses, driveways, footprint? Is there a certain footprint that is acceptable or pretty typical for that?
Yes, so the property that is diagonally across from us is number 18. without using a measuring tape, we went out there to kind of get a good idea because we wanted an idea of, you know, how wide we really wanted the driveway. So it is approximately 20 feet. Again, I didn't go out there with a measuring tape, but it's approximately 20 feet. The driveway right next to us, which is 13 North Mill, they have a gravel driveway, so it's pretty difficult to define the width of that one. And over at 20 North Mill, they also have a wide driveway. And 17, I believe it's actually Laurel Canyon North Mill right on that corner, their driveway is very wide. So I think that, you know, considering the integrity of the neighborhood, it will fit right in line.
To answer your question, Fran, in another way, if this was a brand new house being sited where it is 67 feet away from the public way, our fire chief would require a 20-foot opening unless it got sprinkled. Exactly. So, I mean, I'm not so sure that given all of that, that, I mean, typically, and I think where your question was coming from is, geez, like to reduce the driveway openings as much as we can. I mean, that's you know, flare them out once they get on your property type of thing. But having given what the other regulations are, I'm starting to shift my focus as to what you could or should not allow. That's where I'm at.
Right.
Other questions?
I have a follow-up to
you
the,
go ahead
to the question. Is your intention to take the stone wall and curve it to the end of?
Yeah.
I don't know if that is within our scope of.
We will require that all the town stones remain on the town's land.
Yeah.
If you're curving it just a little bit and still stay on our side, but we have precedent where somebody wanted to take 20 feet and kind of wrap it into the driveway, and we said no to that. Something we've said in the past.
Yeah, our intention,
many times, I think.
Our intention is to repurpose the stone wall the way, however, the town and scenic board requires us to. Right now, there is a slight, you know, angle slope. It's probably about 4 feet worth. You know, whatever the town asks us to do at that point, we'll certainly comply. Whatever stones are left over, there is a very large gap. It's probably towards, well over 20 feet. Closer to Laurel Canyon, probably see it
the west side on the west end of your property.
Yeah. Yeah. We certainly don't have enough to fill that gap, but more than happy to try to close that in a little bit.
With the turning ratio that you're looking for, would that amount of stone be able to fill that void, do you think?
Not completely. No, definitely not.
I think they're talking about according to the map, it says 15 feet and 6 feet of wall would be repurposed, so whatever.
What, anybody got a scale to look at?
The other one says it's 20 feet.
But Mr. Chairman, question. What's for the new developments?
Based on
what's the width of the driveways?
40.
It all depends on which development 40 feet. It is. I don't think we have a standard. Other than.
Do we have a range?
This checker
part. Yeah, about 35 feet.
If you want 2 cars, feet, right? Then you're going to 18 to 20 feet.
Yeah, it looks like 35 feet. But they do have a scale on on this piece here.
Okay.
And from 40 to 80, if you took 40 foot, you would probably get 35 out of that okay. Opening.
Yes, right.
How long have you lived there?
Maybe she just purchased one last one, so just over a year.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And it is a scenic road.
Yes.
And you were aware of that when you purchased the house. My point of view on this is that it's one of the oldest roads in town. It is a scenic road, and the stone walls and trees what you have now. I don't see a reason for us to change. Everyone in town deserves to have senior rooms, wants it.
Sure.
So I would need to see more compelling photographs, explaining, pointing out how it better. Here's the reason you want to do it. I heard that it's hard to come in and out to see the road.
Through you, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
So what is the reason you want to widen it? Is it just to get in easier or parking or?
Well, yeah, a couple of reasons. Backing in and out, because the road is quite narrow, backing out is difficult because we're getting close to the trees on the other side of the road. And then if you try to back into the driveway so you can pull straight out, you're running into the same predicament. So we're just trying to make it safer for, you know, us coming and going whenever we have people in the house. And also part of the plan is to pave the driveway because, again, it's gravel. And having this one particular tree that's in question right now, we're concerned about the root system and the integrity of the pavement once it actually gets laid. And, you know, potentially not lasting very long. So, you know, that's... The biggest thing is honestly sightline. You can't see. Yeah. I don't know if anybody's had the opportunity to drive by the residence and see, but it's
my only concern is most of the driveways that I'm familiar with in the neighborhoods are just single car, 10 feet wide, and that's it. Not on scenic roads, just regular developments that, you know, it seems like that's what we prefer, less pavement, but tends to widens up. So the reason you're looking for the width is obviously.
Through the chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
But you're increasing the hammerhead on the turnaround ratio from the garage over. You want that to be expanded as well.
Yeah, so what we'll do is...
So you won't be backing in and out of the driveway anymore because you have that turnaround that you're creating at the top end near your garage, though.
If there's nobody parked in that turnaround. If there's somebody parked in the turnaround, we can't back out of our driveway, which is... What I try to do right now is back out of the driveway and swing into that and then pull out of our driveway. But if there's anybody parked in that landing, I guess we could call it a turnaround, you can't swing around in the driveway.
But if you make it bigger, there'll be like two parking spots.
And you're increasing that hammerhead quite a bit.
Yeah, when we widen the driveway, that hammerhead will shift over with it.
Yeah, so this coming out of the driveway doesn't seem so pertinent if once your hammerhead is larger.
So long as there's nobody in that spot, correct? Right. But if there's
how many cars are you going to?
My husband and I, and then, you know, his mom comes from New York quite often to visit us. My family comes down from New Hampshire quite often to stay with us as well. That's really when it becomes a precarious situation.
You had earlier mentioned about trees in the root system. Which tree are you mostly concerned about with the root system?
The one on the corner in the drawing is referenced.
The oak?
Yeah, that oak.
The 15-foot oak?
Yeah, it is right.
No, I see that. I'm looking at it right now.
This one, yeah.
And then there's a 10-foot tree that's dead, which is right near it.
Yeah, to the right of that, if you're looking at the house. You can see where the tree's been struck.
This other dead one here?
Yes, exactly. The tree's been struck a number of times, not just by us, but, you know, whenever we have deliveries, which is quite often, you know, trying to let those guys in and out of the driveways. And as you know, North Mill is so narrow, somebody parking on the side of the street to bring something up to our driveway isn't an option.
So are you looking to do anything on the, on the north side of the driveway? No more trees on the north side of the stone wall on the north side?
There's a few trees there that are referenced on the drive.
I see that.
Yeah, there's a cedar tree there. It's well within the property line. And there's a couple of rhododendrons and shrubs that will need to be removed as well.
So those are the property line. That's right on the screen.
Yeah.
Is it Chair?
Go ahead.
Would it work for you if the trees were removed but the driveway would remain at 10 feet? So if you had to get out, you could just drive over dirt if you had to, or truck deliveries on special occasion?
Visually, yes. It would certainly make things a heck of a lot safer. You know, whatever the requirements are for the width of the driveway, obviously we can comply with, but we would prefer to, if we can, to require.
Right. But the trees, excuse me for interrupting.
Yeah, no, just one final comment. I don't, Ken can correct me on this, but I don't think there's a specific width.
We cannot, I'm not aware of any regulation that talks about driveway width.
Yeah, so there's no, we're just trying to work with you. Yeah. And our goal is at least modified that, right? Right. Just for aesthetics.
But I will say that there is a requirement from the fire safety of 20 feet of passable road, which I believe either paved or gravel or.
So can he speak to that a little bit? Like, what's, is that every house down?
So the unique situation you have here is that the trigger of conditions to requiring it don't exist. Please don't miss the point that I probably can't access their driveway with fire apparatus. So I can't get a ladder truck in for sure. I probably do this several houses just because scenic roads are narrower. Right. I can't make the swing. And it, so I'm wondering in here, because I'm not sure of all the factors you're using in your decision, but from public safety, if there's a way if somebody is voluntarily willing to open a driveway up some, it would help us get in to access a property. And certainly, that's the first step. That's more important to me than the width of the driveway, believe it or not. That the first step is whether I can even access the driveway.
So
I know you have a lot of other criteria and variables to deal with, but just for me, accessing it, this would, if somebody wants to do it,
Thank you. That's important. I asked you the same question though. If you had 10 feet of asphalt and 5 feet of flat land with no trees on either side, that would be the same as the 20 foot required. But it doesn't need to be 20 feet of pavement.
That would, the width would help. It doesn't have to be pavement. If it were to meet a new construction, then they'd rate the carrying capacity. But just the stone wall, just we've hit wall on North Mill before. It's sure. The running board of the truck hangs up on the wall, and that's the dilemma. The wall is open, that's the first hurdle.
Right.
So if you did that, that's a big deal. Then
sure enough.
I just want to caution the board that's been hearing on trees and stone walls, not pavement, so we don't regulate how much pavement she can put on her property. Just want to caution you on that.
You can guide her though, right?
You can make suggestions, yes, but it's up to her ultimately. And then just wanted to tell you the second criteria is the necessity for the proposed work in terms of public safety, welfare, maintenance. So that is a consideration as well.
Are there any members? Oh, go ahead, Mike.
I'm a little concerned. Here it is a safety issue going on the driveway. You said you hit the street more than once.
No, we haven't, but you can tell from the photographs the trees with
the I thought you said you have.
No. God, no. My
husband's having
I think, though, that the suggestion by our member down there that the turnaround would be useful. It looks like you're expanding that a bit. And when we talk about safety and things that are measured and there are metrics to them, we have some facts from the chief that we need to make sure that we're not crashing the stone wall here and there. But I just like to see that more factual case plan is in place. Because I really don't see a convincing argument to take down any of the trees other than the dead one, which is the whole tree been there. You'd have to see it in person or have one, someone look at it.
I drove by it this morning and looked at it three or four times, and I can see where it could be hard to get in and out.
Because of that tree, right?
Because of the
one
tree,
reason.
At the same time, this board has walked up and down a lot of these streets, seeing which trees can be trimmed back, which trees can be cut down for safety and for electrical and water. So.
Let's talk about perhaps the conditions that we typically might do. One is either a payment to replace the tree or to ask for two trees to be planted on their property. And certainly moving the stone walls somewhere else. I mean, there isn't too many
many tree huggers there are on this board here. That you're, yeah, I mean, you don't buy a house on North Mill Street if you don't appreciate stone walls and trees. Quite frankly, I buy a house on Ash Street, the reason I bought it was a stone wall. So I take this kind of, like, you know, it's a heavy decision. I don't like deciding death warrants for trees, and there's still a lot. But on the other hand, I can see from the safety aspects, personally, I don't like 20-foot openings. She knows that, but this is a particular case that goes right to it. But that happens to be the rule. If this is a brand new house, we would have to appoint it because they couldn't build, they couldn't replicate that house the way it's built without it. And if you give that kind of logic, then what's the logic to say that you can't do 20 feet here? I personally would like to see that, you know, the, if the stones removed, the rebuilding on the wall, for, that's to me, that's a given condition. And the other one is that the applicant would plant and maintain two shade trees maybe on the front of your lot on your side of the land, so that you're responsible for them. And the unit asks that the tree warden be involved in selecting species and size or subject to approval.
Point of order. Just a quick question.
Yeah.
So we're really just going to make suggestions. We're not going to vote on anything.
No, I think we, you know,
okay.
I'm hoping that we're going to
okay.
vote on
just
it
wondering.
Tonight.
Okay.
I mean, it's...
So we're going to write up some conditions to vote on it.
We have a set of conditions kind of right here. And so basically, I think if I looked at the conditions that were in front of you guys, we'll share here, but this is, we're looking at the second one, just so that you've got the line that issuing of an occupancy permit does not, that has to come out. So basically we're talking about number two is two conditions for approval. Are there any other members of the public that want to offer anything? Okay, seeing none.
We heard you.
Ed, do you want to speak tonight?
Sure.
Okay.
Bring myself all the way up here.
Go ahead.
Ed Harrow, 8 Spring Lane, tree hugger first class. I look at what happened at Spring Street, which is a scenic way, and there were two houses built on that street down past Pond Street, and every single tree that was on the side of the road was cut down. These are rules that we've got in place for a reason, and I don't like it when we are casual about them. I guess my first question is going to be, what is the history? Has there been a history of multiple accidents at this driveway?
Well, I think
it's,
from the picture, there's been multiple times the tree's been struck.
The tree being bumped is not, I'm talking about a car, multiple car collision because of poor visibility, not someone backing into the tree.
Mr. Chair?
I don't think we can answer
that
question.
I thought that I remember I knew what Ed's talking about in the spring. And wasn't that a case where the builder just cleared the trees and was penalized?
Yeah.
And then he was penalized.
Right, because he didn't get approval from the board.
That's correct.
Yeah. I'm saying that that's an issue. And that's part of the reason this is a scenic road. Do things like that, it impacts the scenic road.
Right, so that was nothing that we approved.
I didn't say there was anything you approved.
Okay, just want to make sure that's clear.
If that was interpreted that way, that was not at all what I meant. And my second question is, I'm under the impression that these two letters were sent to the tree warden, which I believe then takes the tree situation to the Board of Selectmen.
It now becomes a two-step process. This board would have to approve it. And
so come to my street, Spring Lane, and try to pull out onto Spring Street between 7 o'clock and 9 o'clock in the morning, or between 3:30 and 6:30 at night. And I think the street is probably 20 feet wide. The visibility is terrible. We've lived there 30 years. And so far, we haven't had an accident. You had one?
Well, that doesn't count. I'm talking about cars in cars.
If I may, Mr. Harris point about how many accidents, that's a metric that I would like to know. Mr. Harrell's point, I live on a scenic road as well. The point about pulling out, pulling in, you just have to be more careful. I don't know where you lived before. I lived in the city before. I lived on a very busy street. I have to be very careful. More careful than now in the country, but still I have to be careful. I still don't see a compelling reason to cut down an old tree. I do like in the plan, I didn't notice it before, where you move the stone wall to fill the gaps. That's, I think, in the spirit of bylaw. My position is the stone wall change, yeah, the tree coming down now. Except for the picture.
So just to,
I've spoken my piece.
Okay. Thank you.
So I'm not too concerned about the way my husband has tried to get out of the driveway, but UPS, FedEx, our grocery delivery every week, our water delivery every week, that concerns me a great deal, because these guys, what they're doing is they're parking into the driveway instead and blocking any traffic for our department, police department, any traffic we're going through, because they can't get into the driveway comfortably. That's really
if you still do the widening of your own driveway, then
can't get into the driveway.
It's right. It's literally right on the corner.
Public.
John, Jack, with David Joseph. One of the things that I think the board really has to take into consideration also is property rights. We're all concerned about the look and the feel of the town.
The scenic roadway is different than that. Your door is left.
These people are not talking about clear cutting. They're talking about making their driveway a little safe. And to the chairman's point, if this were a new house, there would be no question. We would be requiring them to cut down this tree, to move that stone wall, and do all of these things. And to say, well, just because your house is there, you haven't gotten into too many accidents, and the fire department hasn't had to come. Why do you want to widen it? And maybe we'll just keep the driveway narrower and not move the tree, and people can drive over the grass when the fire truck comes. But the grass may not be plowed. And 2 years ago, when we had 110 inches of snow, that could have been a 6-foot wall of ice on that side of that driveway. And so we have to consider more than, yes, it's very important to keep our scenic roads up, but it's also, we're also here to serve the public. We are here to protect the trees and the environment, but we're also here to serve the public. And this is a person coming here for relief. And we should keep that in mind, that they're looking for relief. And if we did this new, we'd be requiring all these
things. I just have one quick statement. I don't see any issue in the removal of, I have no issue with the removal of the 15-foot oak, which is already damaged, and there's a concern with the structure. I also have no issue with the removal of a dead tree. If it's dead, it's dead. So, I mean, to have, and if those are the two trees that are, you know, on the road, you know, in town property, you know, on the scenic road that we have to be concerned about, I don't see any issue with that. The other trees on the other side of the driveway are on her property. I don't think we have any say over that.
Cedar was still maybe on the town's part of the use.
This one question I had is, what is the bylaw? How far into our property line?
Just the property line.
The cedar, it's...
Half and half, maybe? I don't know. I didn't
No, the cedar is inside the stone wall, probably at least 5 feet.
I think she means your question is, I didn't know that's what I meant either. From the side of the road, how much of that is a town property?
It depends on where the property line is. A lot of times it's through the center of the stone wall. Yeah. In a lot of places.
I see.
It's like 5 feet or something like that.
I see that.
Usually for.
Yeah.
Like
the middle of the stone wall. It's a lot of old streets. It's the dividing line.
Point of order?
Yeah.
I see in front of us a resident that is willing to put things back
after they get the widening and is willing to work to for the betterment of the safety, as well as to restore the stone wall to its finite point that it's missing some. Maybe not make the rotation into the driveway with your stone, but relocate that over. I think you're doing a great job trying to do, you know, three things. I'm a tree hugger too, a huge tree hugger, and anyone on this board will hear that.
For those of you, if you've driven by the house, the entire front yard is trees.
Yes.
You bought the house for that reason.
Right. So to my case in point is that you're willing to put two trees on the precipice of where you put the opening anyway, to restore that scenic view.
Yep.
So I personally don't have any problem with what she's about or requesting, but that's my personal opinion.
Okay, let's
try a motion.
Could you
just one final
sentence?
Yes, I'm good with the stone wall being cut back and with the trees coming down, because I think it is safety for numerous reasons to get a 20-foot wide thing. The only suggestion that I would ask, and it's not part of this write-up, and I don't want it to be part of the write-up, but that you consider putting a narrower driveway, because I think it aesthetically would look better, and it would be better for the environment.
Yeah, we came to that 20-foot as a guideline, just from speaking to driveway guys, saying how wide should a driveway be if you want to have two people park, and that's what brought us across the street, which they have about a 20-foot driveway.
But that should be where you're parking, but the actual funnel into the sidewalk, in my opinion, should
more
be
narrow.
10 feet. If we had 20 feet for every single house,
okay.
First point, if we have 5 feet on each side of just room for a fire truck to get in,
right.
Before we would allow some narrow streets. Narrow is 18 feet, you know, and it's two cars that can pass on the moving, you know, so
cars.
Well, they're slowly. You know,
never.
I have a question about this, factual question. So if neither of the live trees were taken down, the dead tree was taken down, and the stone wall was moved as we discussed, how wide could the driveway be then? But it looks like it could be 15 from this. So I
you're saying leave the tree there, but push the opening of the driveway just closer to 13 North Mill?
If 13's over here, yeah.
Is that where the little kitchen is, 13?
Well, it looks like
no, it's the other way. Right.
Yeah. If it's 20 feet, it looks like you need to take down at least one tree.
That's right.
Or two trees. And then, but if you take the sum of the stone wall back over here, then there is maybe 5 more feet in addition to your driveway, as opposed to 10 more feet. I'm assuming that's a 10-foot wide margin here. So if that 15 feet, would that work better? Moving the stone, keeping the stone in place?
I kind of looked a little bit at that, because I wanted to say, but then I looked at the damage, and I said, half of the bark on the back side is gone.
It's probably a matter of time.
And so it's...
That's different than that one.
So, I mean, you know, I was thinking it was an alternate. My initial was, let's just push it a little bit further. And then I've come to the conclusion that the plan isn't, for me, as much as I hate to take trees down,
it costs about 15 feet for the satisfied.
Well, I think he'd get a 15 foot in there, but the tree might stop it literally, because the pavement might be fine, but it is very narrow right across from her driveway. You know, other than the fact it was 9 o'clock in the morning, I didn't want to drive into your driveway, but I almost kind of did that this morning to see how it
unless you're serving coffee.
Tea, for sure. Come on in.
And the driveway, existing driveway, is already encumbered by the tree already.
Correct.
Yes.
So that's the biggest dilemma that you have
Let's try this.
Yeah.
Let's make a motion, and we can go up or down, and then
goes down, we can talk about maybe some suggestions to go for that. Entertain a motion to approve the request with three conditions. The first one is no work will be done until all applicable provisions of the public safety law, Mass General Law 87, will be complied with. That means you've got to go through the hearing with the selectmen. And then the other two conditions that we're talking about, the bottom two paragraphs without that.
So moved.
So it's moved.
Second.
Second. Okay, now we're in discussion.
So, Mr. Chairman, on the second bullet here, the second point, no greater than 20 feet. Stones removed for the 20-foot driveway. So are we saying here maximum width?
I'll take the stone walls, because that's what she asked for, is 20 feet.
Right, she's taking the stone walls, so not more than 20 feet.
Which would be...
No, wait a second. The plan actually shows...
So 21 feet on the plan.
It'd be for the plan. So it'd be...
Stones removed for the driveway opening for the plan.
What do you see, 21, Matt?
I see 20.
I see 20.
I see 20 on the...
Yeah.
I think it's 20 feet on the pavement, and then you're going to be back, you know, a foot or so off the pavement.
Yeah.
If I read this as approximately 15 feet of the wall to be repurposed, another 6 feet of wall to be repurposed, so I see 21 feet.
Being moved.
So actually the opening might be a little bit wider than that. Correct.
So why don't we entertain the 20-foot egress on it, and then the stone be relocated to the wall, and the trees be replaced after...
That's what I think.
Right? Replaced where?
So the one tree, that the oak tree, the other one's a dead one.
Be replaced where?
No, we want two trees. Stick it down two, we want two.
Cedar and oak.
Oh, an eight-inch cedar, a 15-inch oak, and then the 10-inch dead tree.
The cedar's actually within our property line.
Yep.
It's like, well, within the property line. But yeah, that would be removed. And then, yeah, the dead tree is a 15-inch.
Okay, so they're really asking for approval of one tree.
One, yeah.
So
you
I would
take the dead one out of the equation, yeah.
So I'd entertain a friendly restatement of that motion of basically plant one shade tree, because that's all that they're taking out.
Agreed.
Place. So this would be one instead of two.
Is
that acceptable to
the...
Is
this not the property line?
Oh, wait a second. Ah! Ah, wait a second.
What did we...
Oh, you're reading it. Your surveyor's actually shows the property line. The stone wall is
somebody
outside.
Oh, is that what that line is?
Yes, yes. That's the property line. Yes.
Yeah, we had the land surveyed in preparation of this to get the boundary.
So I think we do...
So the property line is well within the stone wall, is that what you're saying?
Correct.
Okay.
That's the way I read that. Thank you, Charlie.
So I think it's just a question of how many trees. You're
okay
with that, right?
I think it is two trees. It is two trees.
So leave it as written.
Yep.
Okay.
Two trees.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
You're going to have a larger area.
Yep.
We can go back to the stone wall. So I'll be leaving it when it's written, or am I changing it to say the stones are moved to the driveway opening for the plant?
Well, the suggestion was that we take the stones without the curve.
It's a 20-foot driveway, and then there'll be a couple of feet.
That's per the plan.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep.
Thank you.
And we will clarify in the decision that none of the low curve things will be there.
Yeah, so that the last sentence is still
not
be used in the driveway.
Yeah, right. Correct. Again, okay.
Are we ready for a vote?
I don't know. Are we ready for a vote? Further discussion? Seeing none, I guess call for the vote. This is motion to approve with three conditions. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no.
Nope.
And anyone else?
It's based on the one tree, that's all.
Okay.
And outside line.
Okay.
So I think that motion was approved. Look for a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
McGarrett.
Okay, motion to close the public hearing is approved. Thank you very much. We will write up a decision probably within a week or so. We're going to have to get on the selectmen's agenda for...
That was my next question. Okay, so I've sent everything to them. So you can talk to Elaine Lazarus in the town manager's office to schedule that.
Okay. That's because there was two letters.
And thank you for doing your due diligence on bringing it to us.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Certainly looking to apply the term of the regulations are, and again, maintain the integrity of the neighborhood.
Excellent. Thank you. And you did a, you did a survey on top of this to find out?
Yeah. Yeah, we wanted to know where a property line was between us and 13, just to be sure we weren't encroaching on their land.
Very good. Yeah. Very good. A lot of work. Thank you.
Yes.
Does your husband take them down, or is he getting professionally?
Yes.
Take care.
Okay, thank you so much.
All right, take care.
Okay, let's see. Brother Lee?
No, he's still out in the hallway waiting for his chance.
He's doing an A&R for Mechanics Bank.
Do you want to give your brother a few minutes to get that approved?
Okay.
So you're the nice one.
Small drop.
You owe me.
So you're the nice one.
I like you better.
Good evening.
Good evening.
John Hemmer Ladder. John Hemmer, live at number 4 Mechanic Street. We are hoping to create a lot for the son David, who's here as well. We were here back in 98 for A&R lot for their daughter Darcy, who is just to the south of where David would like to build. David's looking to build on the east side of the road, about 1,100 feet in from Wood Street. The lot would have 460 foot frontage and 5.8 acres. Mechanic Street is considered a private street. It's quite extensive from Wood all the way going kind of in a northeasterly direction. There's about another 105 odd acres that exist all behind this proposed lot.
So basically, they're going to end up with.
Yep, this is the new lot that's going to be here.
Okay. 461 plan complies?
Yeah.
Okay. Plan complies. Other questions on the board?
Where specifically would it be on this?
So the road is to the right of the Woodville Post Office, and it would be about 1,100 feet in.
Yeah. With those both on this?
Yes.
Entertain a motion to endorse the plan.
So moved.
Second. Move seconded. For the discussion, see how you vote.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, we need two signatures and a date. We'll make up the time for that.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
luck with everything, gentlemen. Thank you. Have a good day, okay?
We'll see you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Now we're ready to open the public hearing for application for minor site plan review. This is Golden Pond Resident Care, 50 West Main Street. This proposal includes the reconfiguration of some existing rooms within the facility and the addition of new resident rooms and patios for this recreational use of the residents.
Hi.
And let's see. I think you have an outline prepared for the hearing, which will follow. Which first part of it is, I know we started about 20 minutes late. And you'll get the extra 20 minutes on the other side too, so don't worry about that. So basically, we'll be following the outline as it goes along. First part of it is kind of a brief introduction and your overview by the applicant.
Good evening. Joe Bogdanat, joined by Harry Cosa of Golden Pond. The motivation behind the site plan that's in front of this board is a change in the marketplace, assisted living nursing homes. The model that Kerry has based on late 70s, early 80s construction and all the changes that have come along in his line of work, kind of forcing them to move away from shared rooms, shared facilities into private rooms. That's where the demand is, that's what his clientele is looking for. So what we have put together and proposed here tonight is an attempt to do that within a certain portion of the existing Golden Pond. As you know, this board, as well as the Appeals and Conservation Commission, approved design circa 2009. The construction was done 10-12. As a result of that, areas along the northeast corner of the building were built up. Dining room expansion, storage space in the kitchen, upgrade of some kitchen equipment, and parking area, as well as some heating and cooling elements. What we want to do is work around that general area and expand upward from there. So just take a moment to introduce the location. This is the site plan, very similar to what was before you folks back in 2009. West Main Street is down here. The Ice House Pond is over here. This was the original location of the entrance. The 2009-2010 permit introduced a second westerly entrance and exit. What we're talking about is that original spot that accessed beyond the front facade with the stationary overhang to this corner on the northeast side of the building. That's where changes took place. That's where the dining room expansion was proposed, the kitchen on the backside here, and the air conditioning cooling along that northeast corner. What we're talking about doing is an expansion in that location. West Main Street is down in here, is that northeast corner. Where all those areas have been built up, we would like to add some patio space for the folks to utilize an outdoor living situation, and then build up on this location, the second and third floor, and rework those rooms from the shared bedroom, shared living space to a single room. Those are the designs that Michael has joined us here tonight. Those are the designs that Michael has put together. That's looking at that side. Here is the cooling, heating, cooling elements right here. The back side is that kitchen upgrade. These are the first floor patios. These will be the reconfigured rooms, second and third floor. And then here is an outdoor space up on the third floor. So what we're talking about is leaving this driveway access alone for vehicular access, the pedestrian walkways for the folks that are ambulatory and want to continue to use those those will be unchanged. What we'll do is fit up patios between the walks and that existing structure that's out there today. And that's what we'd like you to consider this evening.
Jennifer, do you have any comments?
I don't really have much to add. It's pretty minor, other than design review board has not had a chance to look at the architecturals. They meet next week. The board should decide whether or not you want to wait for that or not. I don't think it's a plan worthy of beta review. There's no changes to the actual parking or traffic or any of that, so I don't think there's much for them to review in this case. If you look in your memo, I went through the site plan. They comply with for most of the criteria they comply with for is not applicable because it's existing. So I think the plan itself is straightforward. So
I have a question for you, John. Cool. I noticed that the access road is 12 feet wide. Chief, if may I bring you in on this. You add more residential aspect to that end of the building, and something happens on that, and you've only got a 12-foot egress. What does that say for you in regards to an emergency of sorts?
If I may, I can. I'm not familiar with this. They have the wide all around the backside, which is something we had changed before and we had to improve. And one of the reasons was access to the back. And there's also an egress in the back that goes out to Elm Street for emergency use only. So I think that area is pretty well covered. Yeah, if that jives with what you're...
Let's talk about the detailed discussion when we get down on the outline. I think at this point I'd entertain a motion to vote to find that it meets the requirements of the minor site plan review.
So moved.
Seconded for the discussion on the motion.
Yes. So just a question about the process. Will there be another vote after this, or is this
This is just to say that it's minor and not major.
Thank you.
And that triggers a lot of smaller stuff.
I'm fine with that. Thank you.
Okay. It is under the 5,000 square feet.
I have some questions about 5,000 square feet. The patio sections make sense. The outdoor patio makes sense.
We'll be talking about building design and into the details and outline.
But as far as calling it minor or not, you said the 5,000 square feet, that includes the additional second and third floor work.
Correct.
And that's under 5,000 square feet. Thank you.
Okay. We have a motion in front of us that meets the minor site plan review. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And the same motion carries. Okay. Now the next is part of the outline where the planning board members and the public can add to the outline. Does anyone on the planning board have any other items that you want to add to the outline? And a lot of these are going to go by pretty quickly because they're not terribly flexible. So I think that this is there's almost all the traditional elements that we have in the area. Anyone from the public want to add to the outline?
Well, I revert back to my question to Chief. If I may, just about the traffic. And
we'll talk to about traffic as item A when we get down to the point.
Okay.
So the parking lot design, either one of the two. Okay.
Could we get more understanding on the amount of more water and sewer that would be used by the residents? I know the DPW director said there wasn't a big deal, but you're adding
I believe it was nine more units, and it's probably about less than 60 gallons a day per unit.
That's it.
65.
Well, let me even add to that. What we've done, as Joe was talking about, is we're restructuring some of our semi-private or shared bedroom units in the building, and we're making them into one-bedroom units. So we're taking a two-bedroom unit, seven of them, and making them one-bedroom units. So what we're doing is we're subtracting seven bedrooms from our current existing total, and we're then adding nine. Okay. So the
And you do septic on bedroom basically.
And it says here it's 1,350 gallons per day. Is that
if we had the nine additional? But I wasn't aware of the changes. Fully aware of the changes. Kerry was making with these designs. The two additional beds, what we're talking about, are 300 gallons per day.
they're going to go.
It's almost the wash.
Yeah. Literally.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm not seeing any. Go ahead.
Just a quick question. The emergency generator and the existing drill, the mechanical equipment, is it existing already?
Existing.
Okay, so you're not adding.
That was built 2011.
Okay. I just want to make sure, because if it was not existing, then I want to talk about sound and all that.
Just a utility.
It's already there.
Okay.
One additional question. It could probably go under traffic. I want to talk about the sidewalk on West Main Street, please.
Okay.
Let's start off with the traffic. I'm going to try to make this as quickly as possible, because I think I'm the only surviving member of the board since we approved it way back when. When we did an extensive traffic study, we had a lot of discussion about driveways and sidewalks and all sorts of that type of stuff back in the day. Traffic was a much more concern because it had a daycare center located in it. And with that left, the major concern of everyone coming to drop kids off at a particular time early in the morning went away. And the traffic completely changed. So to me, the traffic per se, even with a net of a couple more bedrooms, it's insignificant. It's 5 employees. I mean, that's what I think we're talking about. I mean, that's insignificant compared to dropping off 70 or 80 kids to get in there. So to me, traffic studies worked the last time. It certainly worked this time. Now, going on to other things.
There were improvements that were made also that
and the sidewalk got put in, and the sidewalk also was connected by the town recently in front of the other houses to that. So traffic to the sidewalk is, I think, continuous from there all the way over to you can get to the...
You want me to bring up my concern now?
Go ahead.
So I think the sidewalk was put in incorrectly. It's at the level of the street and not at the level of the curb height.
The one on our property.
The one on West Main Street on your property. And there's no curb there. I would like to see a curb put there if that's possible as part of this. Everything was done
wrong. Restructure. It's kind of done without...
Let me speak to that for a second, unless you'd like. We got our approvals from the ZBA, and the planning board had some other thoughts, and they were still looking for a sidewalk to be constructed by us. We then appealed that decision and went back to the ZBA, and they basically struck down the planning board's requirement for a sidewalk. So we were then given permission to go forward without any requirements for a sidewalk. I felt all along, and different people go upon, that a sidewalk would be beneficial to residents to go there. And different members of the community at that point in time were looking for a sidewalk to be constructed all the way from the commercial areas all the way to the center of town.
Sure.
Okay. They were looking for us to pay for it. We didn't think it was our responsibility. And the Zoning Board of Appeals found that decision in our favor. Sometime thereafter, the town of Hockington decided to construct the sidewalk.
On the other side of the street.
On the other side of the street, on the south side of the street. In between that decision, when we started constructing things, I went back to the Department of Public Works and the Planning Board and said, you know what, we would like to still construct a sidewalk across the front of our property to help aid the flow of people, okay? And they said, I think it was Westerling, said, if you want to do it, let me check with, different people in town, but it sounds like a great idea to me.
Sure.
So he said, it's on you, right? And I said, yes, it's on us. So we constructed it. We told them how we were going to construct it, and so we did that. Then subsequently, the town then decided to construct a sidewalk across the street.
And we also connected the sidewalk
from our properties on the northerly side
right
through two other properties.
Yeah.
Is that through you, Mr. Chair?
Going westerly.
Westerly
from us.
Right.
So I appreciate that, because it's strictly volunteer for one. I'm hearing, I don't know any of the history of that. But what I see in this town is that the sidewalks are being done completely wrong. They're being done at street level, which, if you look like a town like Westboro, there's no sidewalks at street level. There's all curb level
sidewalks.
And a curb. And there's a grass green belt in between them. And so if I go by, to be honest with you, I appreciate that sidewalk, but if I go by, it doesn't look aesthetically very nice. To me, it takes away from the building. But, so, I mean, obviously, I'm not going to ask you to raise the sidewalk, tear up the sidewalk and raise the sidewalk, but I think we can at least get a curb in there. I don't know if it would fall under this. But, I mean, I would like to start doing things right in town.
Fall under this, but on the other hand, it's a minor site plan review.
Okay, so if we're judging it as minor, I'm okay. I mean, people are hearing what I'm saying.
Let me just throw this out there.
Sure.
At some point in time in the future, we may be looking for, to come back in front of this board here, for site plan review for phase three.
Okay.
Phase three is another 30 plus thousand square feet, another 44,000 beds.
Sure.
At that point in time,
I appreciate that.
You'll stay open-minded.
Yes,
and just so you know, we haven't gotten to the point. I'm new to the board, but I want to build on the zoning bylaw for sidewalks and try to get people to do it the right way. I mean, because there's nothing in place right now. It's just whatever everybody feels like doing. So thank you for that.
Appreciate it.
Any other questions on traffic? See consensus that you're, we'll get the parking lot design. We'll talk about the width. So basically, because of that, we didn't require any traffic.
Well, the only
study, because the existing one basically covers it.
Can I still, yeah. I still ask that we ask Chief about,
yeah,
about that?
We'll do that on parking lot design.
All right.
With, I got it here. Okay, building design. The real question is, in my mind, you know, this is something that we've pulled up for design review. Basically, they have, my opinion, and I'll just state it that way, they've set a building that looks like the rest of the building. I mean, you know, you don't integrate something that doesn't look like the rest of the building when you've got such a big complex. And, you know, you see from the, so I don't know what design review could add to it. You know, they usually, a lot of the building, part of it looks the way it looks because it had design review input two times before.
Right. So, and there's no new signs or anything.
There's no signs, it's just, it's not
were you, even. Were you the original designer of the?
We contributed to the civil on the 2009.
I see.
My concern is, I understand that maybe design review doesn't have to look at this because it's a minor change, however it's termed. But with the additional height in the back and the butters, where would they get into the process?
Is there additional height? I don't think there's additional height.
They were notified of this meeting.
Footprint stays the same, right?
Footprint, yes. Stays the same.
Footprint stays the same. All you're going to do is going up.
Going up and then adding the patio.
The patio, yeah.
But yeah, the building itself is just going out to the existing height.
Right.
Yes, to your point, Frank.
Closer height, not
yes.
Higher height.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a little bit closer to certain abutting properties. But it's still below the height of the existing building.
So if they could, this would be the place.
Yeah. So if you look at what Joe put together here, this area right here, actually it's this area right here, is the area that we're going up. But this is existing, and we're not going as high as this. We're just going here.
The clear areas, the patio, and the smaller lined areas, additional.
Yes, this is the patio area that's existing right now. And from that patio area, we're enclosing it and then going up with the stories. And the stories that are here are 2.5 stories.
Does it show better at the big picture?
Yes, it might. So this is a picture of what's there now. Okay. And so we're building out from that. So this is a rendering showing the facade of the new area. Okay. So this is the existing building, and the existing building comes out to here, includes this tower, and so forth. but the two additional stories we're creating is this area here, which is approximately 20 feet out from the end of the building, and then the width of the building.
But the original patio footprint was already existing.
Yes, correct.
So all you're doing is raising it, going up.
That's correct. Yes.
Now the patio itself doesn't get extended out beyond the footprint, does it?
The patios are slightly different.
Okay. Okay.
These one-story patios.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Do come out beyond the footprint, and that's these areas right here.
I see.
Okay. This represents the sidewalk.
Yep.
That's existing. So the new patios snug themselves between the existing building and the sidewalks there.
Is there an access point for both patios to meet on that, on where they conjoin there? In the corner.
Okay. Let me explain. It gets into a little bit of our programming.
Okay.
These two areas right here represent secured patio areas.
Right.
Secured patio areas are these areas here.
Yes.
If you notice across the front of Gold Pond right now, we have that pergola area with the lattice area.
I do.
So that's a secured patio area that we created so that certain residents that have
Alzheimer's and stuff.
Alzheimer's and intend to flee, they can't get away from the structure because it's a secured area. So we designed that in a way so it looks like an outdoor patio, like a pergola area.
Comfort area.
Yes. So that's what these two areas are here. This area over here is an open free area for the regular residents of Golden Pond who don't have an issue with the need to be in a secured area.
One question about that design though, and I don't mean to go into it, but
yep.
You don't want to make that feel like too much like a cage, right? I mean,
well, you know what's there now, right?
Yes, I do.
So we put a lot of thought time into trying to create a space that didn't feel like
a cage,
a prison,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
a cell.
Because those people still have their, yes, feelings. And
so if you get up close to it, there's cabling going down through there.
Yeah.
And then we around the cabling, we created the lattice, the white lattice area, that looks like an outdoor porch area with lattice on it.
Okay.
So we created window openings so it looks to the person passing by or the resident themselves like they're looking out through a paned window on a lattice porch.
Gotcha.
So that's part of the reason we did that. So we're now mimicking that design on this area down here. And then this area up here, which is for the Alzheimer's residents, we're doing something similar up there.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
So if what you see you like there now, that's what we're duplicating here. If you got questions about it?
Well, I go by there every day. I'm at 86 West Main Street, so.
Feeling of the board that we do not have to send this to design review, given the minor nature of the condition. I've seen a consensus of that, given our people wanting. Okay, I think we, building design is done. Stormwater management, I think it's kind of not applicable because basically you have the same, basically, impervious.
We have about 130,000 square feet of impervious now. We'll add another 1,100 square feet, 0.8% increase in the pervious area. So negligible.
That's negligible.
So basically, close off stormwater. Parking lot design. Basically, there's no real change to the parking lot. The only question that I think Jennifer had one was talked about snow storage. I don't think that changes anything from what the birds have done. And second of all is the width that you were worried about. This first question about the chief, I know, has been to this facility hundreds of times. Unfortunately, I mean, but is the access adequate? Let me just get it down to the nuts and bolts of the question.
It is.
Okay.
That satisfies everything that I need to have.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. I was basing out a little bit on stormwater management. I know nothing major is changing. The last phase, there was issues with the stormwater management and the retention pond back. I haven't heard much lately from people in that neighborhood, but has that issue been resolved? Standing water and issues like that happened at the beginning of the project?
I'm not aware of any issues, right? There was
concern about pest management, mosquito management, and we believe staff will apply as part of their intention to introducing pesticides into the manholes just upstream of the extension basin. And I have not heard anything else from any group, especially services for conservation regarding the function of the lawn.
Any members of the public are also, you know, chime right in. This is part of the public hearing.
To Frank's point,
here to talk about.
To Frank's point, I have walked by there, and the extended basin does hold water for a good period of time.
In the springtime.
Yeah. And so my question would be probably the same thing about pest control or whatever. Other than that, I know that there's a wet area to the right of your road, your access road, before the pond edge. It's all wet in that area, and I happen to be privy to that because a snapping turtle was eating a Canadian goose, and I got it and I brought it down to Tufts University. So that being said, I had to walk through there in order to get the snapping turtle off of the goose. And that is all wet, and it holds a lot of water there. And I'm concerned for the Zika virus coming up and what else is sitting there. So that's of concern of mine. I see that there is some shavings of some sort that have been put down in that area quite a bit. There's quite a bit of either chipping or shavings located in that area, but it does hold water.
You're talking right along the main street there, along the driveway?
Right along the driveway, yeah. If we look,
yeah.
And that's the same access. If we come up to your plan, here's the pond here, and your road comes up through the here. Right in this area here is wet.
Well, yeah, yes. but it's wet because that's the way the pond's been.
The vegetated wetlands associated with the pond, and the shavings are a process of removing invasive species and disposing of dead dying trees, which was part of our permit, which is still a viable permit with the Conservation Commission. So that's part of a long-term process to take care of invasive species and get rid of the dead dying trees. Because of the nature of the users of that path,
sure.
It was to be more cautious with fallen limbs and dead trees so that there weren't any spills along that path from the elk.
Well, you understand what I'm saying, you know, because the Zika virus is a big concern now for everybody.
Okay. I think you're well beyond the scope of where we really need to be.
Well, it's just to Frank's point.
I mean, it's...
I concur with Cliff on it. It is an issue.
These old folk are going to be outside.
It was a major issue last time, and I heard a lot about it, and I had to go down there, and yeah, there was standing water, and it hurt as a crop of the palm, and it wasn't this, you know, wave it go away. It was a year and a half or 2 years before it was resolved. I don't even know if it is resolved. But the neighbors aren't here, so...
I mean, it's a Conservation Commission matter rather than
the board. Through stormwater management, so a stormwater management issue.
So with respect to your concern about mosquitoes,
yep.
We did do some research on that, and we came up with a process, something called mosquito dumps. I don't know if any of you are familiar with them. But essentially, it's a donut-shaped type of treatment that you basically throw in the still water and or the manholes, as Joe was saying. And it kills all the larvae naturally.
Yeah, it resembles a urine cake.
Yep.
It's introduced into the standing water, ideally at the last structure before it heads out into the pond, breaks down and flows with the water into the pond and releases a pesticide into the water. So these insects that need water to breed or to hatch their eggs are killed off in the process. That was introduced in the design at the request of the Conservation Commission.
And we've been doing that for the last 3 or 4 years.
Mr. Chair, the only time I know it's going to make is just like the sidewalks, it seems like they're going to be coming back with a phase three. Maybe take a good look at it because there's probably going to be stormwater study done. Right?
Phase three will trigger stormwater.
Yeah.
Yes, a lot more.
We'll get another shot at it.
There you go. That sounds right to me.
Okay. I think parking lot design is done. Lighting, I didn't see any changes to the lighting. so I think that's not applicable.
If we go back, Chair, snow storage, does that change at all with the extending of the 20 feet of the patio?
No, well, the patios will be adjacent to the walkways. Whatever was pushed temporarily up the storm will now have to be pushed 30 feet further
somewhere
down
else.
The line. But snow storage, mass snow piles, were never intended for that location and haven't been there throughout the life of the building.
So there is no change in that.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the landscaping, the screening aspect, your rendering shows some shrubs right around the new patio, etc.
We're taking down a few trees and we're adding a few more back. I like green things.
Okay, utilities are unchanged, I would assume. Everything's underground if I remember correctly.
One thing I like to see is
the
prospect of solar panels on the
building.
The new higher up roof that you're putting on there.
The pergola.
It's our roof.
How are you going to put a solar panel?
And it faces north.
There's a new roof. It's the second and third floors.
To Frank's point, I would just ask the applicant when they designing phase three if they can look at.
Okay, fair enough.
I have them at my house and they're great.
Construction manager, Fred, when you start, you know, this is relatively small, what's your plans?
I hope to start sometime next month or two here.
See, how long do you think I'll take?
4 to 5 months.
Thank you.
Okay. I think we're now on item five. There's no public comment so far. Site plan standards. I think you saw Jennifer's demo.
Yep.
That basically, in her opinion, everything applied basically. Let's see. Have any conditions that you thought might be
created? Yeah, they're right after the site plan standards. It's a site plan vote condition. They're pretty standard.
Okay, so we put
you probably take number 2 off.
Let me go through those really quick. First one says in the case of snow exceeds the amount to be safely accumulated or in the plan. Get rid of it. Screening of hardware, we've done that on every one except the one recently. But that was Dover Amendment. Dumpsters will not be emptied. I believe that's what you currently have as condition, I think.
I think so,
make sure that you don't create any dust sillation whatever. Remove construction debris. Six is that this little inspector needs somebody else who's going to pay for it. And then there's a $5,000 performance guarantee. And then construction will occur during the hours that we allow construction to go on. 7 to 7, so Friday and Saturdays. Those potential conditions acceptable?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else have comments? Members of the board? Okay. Any more public comments? Yes, Pete.
I might have missed one part here where it would fit in. Last construction project we had, the workers' vehicles were quite a challenge, so I don't know whether we do that in the construction plan or other viewer piece, but it really challenged us keep maintaining the access.
while you were doing the project. So this is a smaller project that I'm sure you can do, like, especially going into phase three. If I could just share that part with you, it was a big deal.
That was the challenge factor.
Okay.
With only one access to the property.
Right.
There's a lot of empty parking spots.
Yep.
Because it replaces a lot of times.
Sounds good.
Okay. Any other public comment? Okay, I would entertain a motion to find that the site plan complies with the site standards contained. Yeah, we're going to do that. We'll do that at the end. I'd like to keep the hearings open so that we can get dialogue and more feedback if we need it.
Thank you.
Other boards don't do it that way. So I entertain a motion to find that the site plan complies with the site plan standard contained in paragraph 210.136.1 with the 8 conditions that we talked about in the first memo.
7.
Eight on the back.
Oh,
I move that motion, and I want to highlight that it's based on the fact that the abutters have all been notified.
There you go.
So basically, that is a motion that says both of them, that complies with the standards, with the conditions, and we approve the site plan with the conditions. So,
second.
Move second. Further discussion. Seeing none. How do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Site plan is approved with conditions.
Just noting that.
Entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. Move seconded. For the discussion, seeing none, how to vote?
Aye.
Say aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Public hearing is closed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
And
good luck, guys.
Good luck.
We will be writing this decision probably within the next week or so.
You're doing a good job over there, by the way.
Trying.
You looking for a spot there?
Yeah, I'm getting there. In the third floor unit.
I'm going to get a name up on a wait list.
Right. Okay. Now we are sufficiently behind schedule. We are
25 minutes. Well, that was
the nice
thing.
Driveway. Thank you, John. There's so much going on. Driveway. Okay. Okay, we're missing John. I assume you want to go forward. Okay. Open the public continued public hearing. The application to amend Legacy Farms master plan special permit. This is a proposal to increase the number of dwelling units by 188 restricted units. And come on down, Roy.
Hi, Roy. Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening.
Okay. We were proceeding along on the outline, and we kind of finished last time with a kind of an overview by the applicant, and we had the general overview. I think we're on item two, which is the planner's report.
Sure. So mostly for my report, I was just going to go over some affordable housing items for you guys, because I know you had some concerns about that aspect of this project. So I know in your package I gave you a copy of the updated sample deed right of the DHCD that survives foreclosure and requires affordability in perpetuity. I've worked in other communities with this deed rider successfully and with a restricted unit successfully. So I think it's a good deed rider. I know you have a lot of concerns about projects you've done in Hoppington in the past. Those deed riders are not the same as these deed riders. They did not survive foreclosure. They were not executed correctly by DHCD. So now you have oversight with, you have staff that can handle a lot of that for you. So I think a lot of those concerns and fears should be allayed because of this. I email from the Mass Planners listserv with a question about age-restricted affordable housing. Didn't get a lot of bites back, but I did speak to Groton, the town of Groton, and they have successfully sold and resold age-restricted affordable units. They are happy with their project there and not have any issues. So that's, you know, where I am with it. I don't think, in my experience, it's been a problem. I know Royce also said that. There is also a letter in your package that we received a while ago from a lawyer that Roy hired to write some direction regarding affordable housing. So I know that you have had a chance to look at some of that. So I don't know if there's any specific questions you have about affordable housing that I can help you with. I do have some experience. I was on formal housing trusts and ran lotteries and did a bunch of stuff in other communities, so I can help you with some of that.
But. Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
I could comment. By the way, I agree with everything Jeff has said. We've recently engaged the services of the consulting firm, as well as Rust. All she does is affordable housing sales.
Yeah, I know her very well. She's great.
Yeah, she's great. She's one of the tops in the field. She was by our office last week. We've got the proposal for her for this. She concurs that the new DHCD documents are fully inclusive. It protects the town from foreclosure, from transfer, from anything, frankly. It's reported with the deed at the time that the property is sold and just cannot be changed. She's also confirmed that I'm happy to get a letter from her, or if you'd like her name, we can visit with the board, I can ask her. She says that she has no problem selling affordable age-restricted units. If anything, she says there's usually multiple buyers for each unit. It's interesting, the requirements, because I didn't know this, and she told me, the requirements for a person buying an affordable unit, obviously one person has to be over 55 years of age. You can actually have assets worth up to $275,000. So whether it's other real estate, whether it's cash, or whatever it is, up to $275,000 at the time that you're actually closing on the property. I forget what the income numbers are, but they're quite high.
Yeah,
so
they're based on the region, and for Hoppington, they're recent.
So when you look at the cash availability or assets, and you look at the income, it's a very, very, she says, it's a very odd opportune thing for a lot of people who are 55 to be able to own something in Hoppington, a unit like that. Let's say a market rate unit was 500, 550, pick a number. These units would be $180,000. So it's a tremendous opportunity for someone to have housing at a very reasonable price, and there is definitely a higher demand for it.
Okay. So,
I think
you were did Wayne have anything you should want to add? Let's check off number two.
Just to get remind you that this county had already approved the zoning change. Otherwise, I've already mentioned that a couple times. So.
By one vote.
Letting everyone know.
Lots of
it's true.
At one time.
This is true.
Two or three times to count too.
That's true, right?
Can I bring to note? This here, we'll be talking about a lot of that stuff later.
Okay. All right.
the now is the opportunity to add to the outline by the public and the planning board, and so anyone from the public have any additions to the potential to the outline. I have two things I want to add. One would be the deed writer itself. I had a lot of some questions when I read through that. And then,
as a subsection of maintaining portability, or
yeah, we can do that under that. And the other one would be we're planning on having a visit to some of the neighboring projects. And I thought we might put a discussion point on that, so we could discuss it in public hearing after we have some observations. And last weekend got canceled out. I personally can't do this.
I come
inside on Saturday, but
any day of the week is fine also.
But other members of the board could do it.
No, it's Saturday. Not this one. No.
I think probably ours is Saturday. So we're talking about, see, our next meeting is on the
26th.
How about the 24th? That would be good. So let's.
Saturday, 24th.
Yep. 9 a.m. meet here at the town hall. We'll carpool to wherever we got to go to.
Just give me like itinerary or places.
Well, I'll give you all that.
Okay.
I think we'll be going to Holliston, and if you'd like, we can then go to Acton if you want to go to second one. But I'll get you all the details.
Anyone else have anything else you want to add to our outline? Seeing none, we've got an outline to go for. So now we're into general discussion. The first one was kind of a recap of the benefits to the town. We kind of listed it in a bunch of ways. Everyone remembers the presentation that we did last time. I think we heard most of these items for about 20 minutes. But we might want to recap some of those items when we're in the presentation. Maybe this would also be the time for people to ask more questions at this point, too. So, first one, benefit to Roy was taxes. Most people don't view taxes as a benefit, but I guess in the context of sitting on the town side,
someone else is paying the taxes.
Right. Unless you want to afford building, that's not important.
Right.
These were all in the presentation from last time, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah. Somewhere I'm trying to
find. Do you want me to just take the
first
page?
Yeah, why don't you do the summary of the taxes, yes.
Well, the problem, and I didn't bring up this information, but this would be trying.
You want this? You want this in?
No, I can do it. Hopefully my memory will pop off. You'll put me back on the right track. So when we had the initial analysis done on the commercial, the taxes were, I think, 140,000 a year.
160. 160?
That's okay. That's not $160,000 a year. And this, again, was done with Judy Barrett numbers. This is not us making up the numbers. The component of doing the age restriction was much more beneficial to the town, something to the tune of $1,500,000. And the reason for that is most money that comes into a town, usually 50% more, goes towards the school system for all the homes in town. So when you take a development that has significant taxes with no contributable school component, basically the vast majority of the money falls to the bottom line. Granted, this, like everything else, is a little bit of fire, but CMS, whatever. So the reason this is so profitable to the town, or revenue positive, if you will, is because of the life of school children. So you've got $1.5 million a year versus $160,000, very beneficial. You've got the three payments that we agreed to give to the town of $120,000 each, total $360,000. That would be going to the selectmen for their discretion, but my understanding was we're sort of geared towards, I believe, the $5.
Okay.
Yeah, for life safety and what the ambulance, I'm not sure. And that was a general question of the fire department in, at the time when we got the selectmen. So we've got that. Another benefit is far less traffic because rather than having a commercial component with heavy traffic use in the morning and the evenings and late afternoons, this is going to be much less traffic, partially because it's residential and partially because it's an age-restricted product where you've got people coming and going at different hours because there isn't directly a 9-to-5 aspect to it, if you will. The other component, which is, I'll call it sort of benefit slash mitigation, is we are putting in the gas lights for the LNG facility, which we believe not only would be beneficial for the residents of this community, but also for the residents.
Was there money that the town was going to use for the downtown project, or is that the
So the other thing we agreed to do is pay to the town, it was $1,750,000, I don't know the numbers right, about $1,800,000, over a period of 3 months, remember the first one was paying for sure, to the town for downtown improvements, I believe is Lawrence and the utilities below ground. Half of the money is for that, and the other half of the money is for the trail system outside of the legacy itself. So these trails will be wherever the town chooses to put them. So it's a significant
money. Yes. Yeah, just to further enhance that, the downtown project has three components of it. One is the utilities underground, the second is a bike path in the center of town, and the third one is the streaming out big intersection for the same business.
So that's what we've allocated.
Yeah.
I know that. Yeah. I know that we're at the cross point to try to either straighten that out or take it back over to the
maintenance. Those are the three components of that project. I don't know what they're putting the money for.
I think we've decided where it is. Sidewalk, big bike path, probably paid for by the state.
Okay.
You know, the revenue utilities, they say, well, we pay taxpayers, and it's an offset. I think to restate it, $1.5 million for those type of benefits, kind of bringing it through, $360,000 for $1,000 for public safety for our tax program.
Thank you.
So
the $1.5 million, you take out the $160,000, so you're a little over $1.3 million net.
Plus,
it's 1.5 net because it's 1.8. Okay.
Sure.
So that 1.5 net. There's no way to know, but I mean, it's an age-restricted community. You're going to have more emergency services there than you would in a commercial.
I mean, well, no question, probably more commercial, but I think you'll have somewhat more than, I would say, 155 neighborhood just by sheer demographics, but I don't think it's going to be significant.
Roy, may I ask, Richard, the age restriction is, as Jim pointed out to me today, that the owner has to be 55 years of age or older.
It's one of the, well, owner or occupant.
Owner or occupant. Okay, so.
When I say occupant, someone permanently lives there.
Okay, so then we move forward to that. No school age children under the age of 18.
Sure.
But then anyone over the age of 18 can live there.
That's a good question. They might be able to, but they can't use the school system.
Right. You see, that was one of my biggest.
That would be an unusual situation because usually when someone's over 55,
their children are grown up.
Yeah, let's put it this way. It might be one or two that, you know, could happen. Sure, it could happen. You know, the child loses a job, they lose their apartment, they have to live for 6 months. You know,
But the bottom line, it's not going to be effect on our school system.
Or you know, maybe his son or daughter's the elderly resident.
Alright, so to follow up with that is that one out of every 10 buildings are age restricted? Is that
one out of 10 units?
One out of 10
units. One out of 10 are affordable.
Affordable. All of them. Okay, that's what I was looking
at. Yeah, men are not age.
Right. They're all age restricted.
All age restricted.
But one out of
10%
right.
are affordable. So it'd be 18. The simple math is 18 units.
Okay, and so they're spread out over the whole.
Distributed equally throughout the site.
Okay. All right. That's where I wanted some clarification. And the only thing that I was concerned about was the age of the 18 to 25 year olders can be a little bit raucous, and most people that are in age restricted areas want it to be like a quiet area.
Yeah.
So that's where the concern came in for me.
I think you'd find, you know, we can ask these questions when we go visit the sites, but you're gonna find the vast majority of age restricted communities have basically age restricted people living there. Now, my husband be 55, my wife is 49, sure, vice versa, I can easily be.
Maybe the husband's 66?
And then
they couldn't help
but, but where I go with this now,
why couldn't the wife be 61? That's 29.
Exactly. The only thing that I want to add to that, to the whole thing, is that a lot of kids today are staying home longer, and we all know that. I mean.
I think that's probably true, but I think the flip side is if somebody's moving out of that house where the kid is and they're moving over 55, I think they've made the conscious choice and they want the kid going with them. Otherwise, they just stay in the house.
Aren't these also vets, two-bedroom?
That's all they are.
Oh, that's even better. Okay, so that kind of helps everything narrow down, and I hope that says enough for everybody to understand.
They're actually restricted to two-bedroom.
Good.
Do they have basements?
Well, that takes care of that.
But anyway, no, it actually doesn't, because when you really think about it, the town is very careful about this. The condominium documents are very specific. You can't add rooms, you can't add dormers, you can't finish a basement. You can't do anything unless you buy it or get permission from the condo association and or get permission from the town.
You can't finish a basement, you said?
You can't finish it if you don't go for the condo association.
And also, from what I read,
that's why you can do anything.
But also, any investment over the price of the condo, you don't get back anyway because you're a lot.
That's only on the affordable.
That's not the affordable.
Only on the affordable. Okay.
Well, my guess is the affordable people aren't doing it anyway, because if you buy it for 180, let's say you sell three, it's not the place maybe get 183.
Right.
You're not going to. There's no windfall, and that stays in perpetuity.
Right. And that's because of the rider, right, Jen?
Yeah.
Yep. All right. Chair.
Sure.
Earlier, Roy, you mentioned some of the benefits to the gas lamps. You said that was a benefit from the street neighborhood. Can you explain how that
works? Well, one can argue, yeah, this is all theoretical, because I realize it's extremely small. If something were to happen, if something were to migrate, you have to take a direction. You can't get by some of the gas lamps because of the board of your car. Most likely be important
to
get
that
approval
right
now.
May or may not.
Yeah.
But a lot of that is.
Hopefully,
we'll never find out.
And it's not, I somehow would like us to deal with the gas.
Just to make the adjustment.
Pointing out the air improvements, we'd like to have them all approved.
I think that's moving beyond where we
are. It's not
really perfect.
It's not right.
Okay, so general benefits. Are there further questions on the benefits of the town? If we get a conceptual plan for what this thing might look like,
we gave it up. I guess it's very conceptual.
Here.
We have still in front of us Ray Marrez.
We've got lots of stuff to talk about. We'll talk about the conceptual plan.
Yep, I'm looking at it too.
think the biggest point to make with this is, number one, this is a concept, 30,000 feet elevation type of thing, as opposed to how one would get those number of units in it. Kind of clear that the amount of space that only duplexes or row houses could ever work.
Yeah. Given the fact that we become constrained due to the LNG line, as much as we like to put a simplex, we're not going to work.
And this one, this concept included a small
clubhouse. Pool area, terraces, that type of thing.
Are all the people that you're talking to basically to do the actual development, are they interested in a clubhouse, pool house, or is that so?
I mean, to different degrees, and very conceptual. I think everybody has the general feeling of a clubhouse with some amenities makes a lot of sense. Now, if we had 200-300 units, not 250-300, which your town support more amenities, sure you could. But I think it's something of this scale, that's the right proportion. If you look at the clubhouse that Alta Legacy has, or the pool and that type of thing,
is that, would that be that location right at the entrance there?
Conceptual,
yeah.
Yes, the look red top.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Is there a pool there, you said?
Well, again, it's conceptual. We haven't drilled down that far. I think the pool would go there, or extended barbecue areas, terraces. I think until you do your market study what the market wants, it's premature to say yes or no to the pool.
Sure. I think having some kind of gathering place, sense of community, distinguishes this from, I'm going to say, the multi units that are literally right down the street.
Right.
And I think that, to me, that's kind of important to have that. Also, our senior center was built with a certain limitation on size, basically. I'm going to put it that way. I mean, it handles our current senior population pretty darn well, but adding another 180 to 360 more that are really into that unit, while they will be welcome there, I'm sure, maybe having something else makes it easier so that they have kind of their living close to home within what I'd say walking. I don't know.
I would disagree with that. I mean, they have the shuttle and we have a spacious senior center. And the fact that this is an addition to what you talked about at town meeting, unless you take some of the units out, it just seems like it's an extra building.
I don't think it's looking in the context of occupiable living space. It's really community space. It's accessory space. Usually in the zoning, accessories like this are not part of the ground building.
It's also taxable.
Chair, you said 180 to 360 units or people? Okay.
Yeah, but you get per unit?
Yeah, no, it's a chair.
Maybe it'd be.
That's what it would accommodate, right?
Yeah, I thought maybe I just missed
owner and significant other. So,
yeah, that's a good point, Ken.
15 and 15 is
what?
Some might be snowbirds.
A lot of parties up there too. Please come up and think on
this. While we're looking at the concept, what was the concept over in here, just to have a second egress?
We just put a dog lane in case the fire department wanted emergency access, or if they wanted us to bring it all the way up, we could. Right now, the children can come in unless it's emergency access.
Oh,
Jake, you may want to look in that.
Could speed? That? Yeah. Roy? Could that curve along that dotted line for the
Chief likes that idea.
Yeah, I think
it's always nice to have two.
I did longer chief that didn't walk
into that.
But
Well, the planning board would probably like that one too.
So yeah.
We're into this type of stuff yeah. too.
And we can make it a full thoroughfare.
But that
line,
that
line with units there.
No, it's more units, it's just access.
The dotted line indicates the LNG, right?
Correct.
Okay,
correct.
So you wouldn't go through the LNG dotted line, but just
through the road.
All
the roads go through it.
Yeah.
Lazy
kind of
roads.
But that okay, so yeah. But you could probably put that right on the edge of that.
Right. You don't have to.
How do we even have something?
Yeah.
Legacy Convoy itself goes right through it.
You'd have to look at how it fits with the intersection.
Yeah, we don't have topos or anything.
Yeah, right.
It's very early.
Yep. It looks good though.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
I think I've seen it.
Other questions on the conceptual plan?
I'm still on a point that you received an email from a resident regarding the conceptual plan. I don't want to discuss that. I'm just here.
Sure. You want to talk about it?
Yes.
What?
Yes.
Basically, I think the concern was potential for
Gigilia, right?
Yes.
For trees. Out on this, where the
sure.
trees that you're concerned about?
Well, I was going to actually use Photoshop and line number, but I know that the trees start Kruger, right?
Yeah, correct. It is.
This is Kruger right here.
Yep.
And they start down, the trees actually start past Kruger and go. I don't know what angle exactly they go at.
This would be helpful or helpful.
Yeah.
Here's
Kruger.
This is green.
Okay, so the trees actually are, I think they probably start about here and go back like this. So I had seen the restricted land layout.
Do you want me to lay it out? So I got a copy of your letter today.
Okay.
General Sledger. So I had my people actually take the aerial of the trees on Google, lay the original commercial on it, and then superimpose this on also. So you're right, the tree line comes down sort of like I'm going to draw a line. It sort of comes up here, and it kind of comes up like this, and it kind of comes along, and then it kind of comes sort of
right.
something like that. And so the difference between again, this is very conceptual. What we can do at the right time is we would do a topo plan so one would see the grades, because this drops down. This actually drops probably a good, I guess, 40 feet from this elevation to this elevation. So everything's stepping away. Our goal and our intent is to leave, in fact, a border. These are fairly sizable trees up here. I mean, I'm going to guess they're 40 feet or more along here. So our goal is to leave these. So actually, all these homes will actually be backing up to forest, if you will, or woods, and there'll be woods along here. Granted, we'll be taking some trees here, but we're not in any way matter taking down the entire woodlands.
I've talked to some of my neighbors and concerned. We already do get flare, and I mean, even for the sake of the tenants, you know, we get flare, odor, and sound over here from the gas plant.
I'm told by the gas company that when they do these, and you'd love to know better, but they'll be doing these upgrades and renovations, the use of that flare is going to be far less frequent. Have you heard that also?
I have not heard that. I can see.
I was told that.
I can see. Flare operates really on two types. One is if something's going wrong, you just got to get rid of gas. But the other thing that they use the flare to do is to burn off also undesirable gases that are separated during the liquefaction process. The second
one,
some
of the odor that we get from there, I'm guessing, and I'm not able to confirm this, is from where they store the odor that they add to the gas.
Perfume.
But all I'm saying is that I mean, if you make this less, it's going to, not only for our neighborhood, but for these people, it's going to be a lot for them.
Yeah. Again, when we go through site plan review, the planning board, we look at this in more detail, we'll be able to have topos and overlays and what trees are going to be. We'll have a very detailed analysis for the planning board at that time, but that's a much later process.
Also, you got some, this is just a concept that are right kind of on the line. That thermal line right in that area. That
is this restricted land in here? Is that why you can't?
This is what, this is what land right in here.
But I mean, like, why can you not move this way?
This is a 30,000 feet. We haven't even designed it. This is, we call this a proof plan.
Yeah.
It's just something to prove you can do it, and then later on.
I mean, frankly, I think you're going to want even more than those trees. These people who are right close to it.
Again, we have designed it.
Yeah. Just from the experience of living in it.
Yeah. No, we're very cognizant of that, and we'll work closely with the planning board and get details for that.
The lower part, or sort of northmost part, which is lower down, is that part of the property too, but just it's not buildable because of the steepness, or is that not part of the property?
I'm not sure what
area it is.
Where both is feet?
Actually, the property line is what you see. Yeah.
This is owned by Cliff and Tommy Ashland.
Ashland.
I think that might be where it is.
It's very steep. So.
The bed for the House Street well line.
Okay.
Is that there?
The water
treatment.
Yeah. Awesome. It's like the board. It's yeah, because this is the board right here. So this has got to be Hopkins.
Yeah, okay.
I think it's this.
Oh, what was that?
Ashland.
But it's in Hopkins. Stone line, stone line, town line.
Yeah, I think it is because you've got Ashland here.
So, Roy, the G is for gas line? Roy? The G going through is gas line? Superimposed
and going through here. See the G? Oh, that was a gas line, yes.
Yeah.
Right?
So
that, yes,
that's it runs along the Legacy Road, right?
Right. That's the gas line of that Legacy Road.
Should buy that piece of
land. I can't believe what that is. I can't tell.
It's very steep. So question related to that through the chair. So this conservation land, is that town land or no?
No.
Okay.
That's part of
essentially it's open space.
That's part of your open space, right?
Yeah, part of the 500 acres.
Okay. That makes the numbers work, right? Right.
It does. Yeah.
Okay. So, any other questions on the conceptual plan? And everyone understands kind of what we're dealing with. Let's try to get through traffic concerns. Somebody had a question. Somebody hit me up with a question at the end of our last meeting. Try to explain in more detail why the traffic is a lot less with this versus the industrial portion.
Well, that was my question, so probably was me.
Okay. So again, we've had. We did it. So what happens is one of the least users of traffic, at least on a steady basis, is age-restrictive as an active adult because of their work hours and non-work hours. So you've got normal residential, which has heavier traffic, 7 to 9, 3 to 6. You don't have that with age-restricted as much, so number one. But more importantly, you don't have what 250,000 square feet commercial would be, which is huge early morning traffic and evening traffic. So you have, say, 7 to 9 heavy traffic, 3 to 5 heavy traffic, and the traffic numbers are monstrous. So it's much more peaceful, less wear and tear and rapidity, Wilson, and the lives, so just all around better for the community.
No, I don't necessarily argue that point. The only thing I would say is, if we look at ourselves around this table, some of us are over 55 and still working on Monday to Friday.
We say over 50, and I feel the same way, but when I say over 55, it could be 55 to 95.
Correct. Right. No, I understand. But
obviously,
we're restricting still working to over 55, so you'll have people in there 55, 60, 65, but we're still going to work
66.
Through the chair, I have a comment on that. And we're going to discuss this a little bit before, but 180 units, and as Kenneth pointed out, that's 180 to 360 possible drivers. Sure, maybe in rush hour there would be less traffic. But as Brian is saying, people 55 to 65 would still be working for the most part. And versus just talking pure traffic, the 200,000 square feet of commercial space would be roughly 200 to 250 workers and 200 to 250 automobiles making.
It's actually one worker for 300 square feet. So it's actually 300,000. It's up as high as 600.
Yeah, they make more cars than commercial.
But with all due respect, they're coming in. All the traffic in the morning is going out, which is where those people would be going to.
Yes.
Coming in, there's nothing. I live on 85, and I watch the traffic going downtown every day. There's nothing going towards Milford. So I understand. I've had trouble with your traffic people. The last, I don't know where they get their data. It's just, I'm not buying it.
Well, but no where they get their data, they don't make this stuff up. It's, you know, there's AASHTO standards. So there are very specific guidelines for residential, for affordable, for age-restricted, for commercial, for retail. I mean, these are industry standards that they use. Now, one can argue, you know, which direction they're going, what hours, whatever, but one thing you can't argue with is the amount of traffic for the age-restricted units is substantially less than any commercial use.
It may be, commercial use. But you're adding to the exit of town. You're adding at least 180 cars every day, leaving town to go to work. I'm 55. I could buy in your development, but I have to work till I'm 67.
No,
that's option for me.
Yeah,
that's 12 years.
But I guess my point is, even if you were to cut the numbers in half or to a third in the commercial component, it's still going to be more traffic. Because remember, commercial doesn't necessarily just mean I come in the morning or I come in the night. You get all day long of, you know, people coming and going, you know, offices, tenants, or clients, or whatever the case may be. So I guess my point is, for sure it's less. You can debate, is it half as much, a quarter as much, a third as much, whatever the number is, it is less.
I can't argue the number, but my point is, the aggregate is leaving town. They're not coming in, whereas those people, the 200,000 square feet, would be entering town, which is much less travel.
You have to look at it this way. They've been doing both, and it's about the number of trips. So people coming to commercial will be coming into town, then leaving town. Then a new set will be coming into town and leaving town all day long. So commercial would have more number of trips throughout the day than
correct.
Residential, whether it be age-restricted or not, who are going to leave town once and come back once.
But from 7 to 9, they're all heading down 85, heading north, versus coming into work where they're coming up 85.
So we're talking one time during the day versus, I think Roy's point is, generally, traffic is less.
Yes. Okay. But after 9 o'clock, I could walk down the middle of Main Street half the time, which is not a problem until 5 when I can't even see Main Street.
Well,
so it's kind of the certain times of the day when it's going to be.
Well, that may be true, but it depends where they're coming from, too, because when you talk to the traffic people, granted, this is over, let's say this is the corner of almost at Bradford, you know, Wilson, St. Ruffin. But it depends where you're coming from. Someone could be coming from Ashland, which means they're coming right up through the center of Hopkinton. They're probably going to come up Legacy Grounds Road north, you know, come across and down the hill and over that way. So those are some people. You have other people coming from Holliston, which may be coming multiple directions into the center of town and going down 85. You may have other people coming from Route 9, which come in. So there's multiple ways to get here. So you can't say specifically it's all coming from one direction.
It will be if they're all living in the same
way. Yeah, what I think, right. To his point.
No, because they're going to go different.
If I may.
There's only two ways out of it.
Why don't we continue this discussion? Yes. And why don't you have your traffic guys pull out the trip part that was part of the master plan, special permit? I mean, there's a traffic study that's about this thick, or maybe it's only this thick, but it's huge. And you're kind of, I think it's a good discussion to to you know, to get that if you don't feel comfortable, maybe you get PHP or something.
No, I'm happy to do that, but I think I'm in a higher slice of this is far less intense in all aspects of learning and motion use.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, maybe not absolutely.
What it does is
let's schedule something.
Lead off with that for the next time, and
we'll leave it unchecked, right?
We're leaving it unchecked for right now, and let's see, I know you want to get a couple of A&Rs approved and a few things signed, so we've got a couple other minor businesses to do, so I'd entertain a motion to continue this public hearing to 8:30 on September 26th.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. And I think maybe we also get the... And get a discussion between you, Ray, and that folks here. So next item, we're here, right? We have an A&R plan for 0 Wilson Street.
Legacy North is one big parcel, and what we're proposing is to be an A&R for this parcel here. This would be the first takedown for the whole team as we're coming in here.
Okay, so basically you're dividing it because you're going to sell
in pieces. Correct. I'll be coming back to you probably about 7 or 8 different times.
Okay.
Over the course of time. And this is the first part of
So basically, if I remember the construction management plan, while they're doing that one, they're going to be piling dirt on your property elsewhere.
Right, yeah. Matter of fact, so here's what they've asked us for, just to tell you how sufficiently petrified this people. They called me last week and they said September 15th is coming up. Well, there's a big pile of dirt over the site that Ludlow has left, and the bus is taking it out. And since we're scared of Mr. Weissman's going to blame us for it, and we have nothing to do with it, so you've got to do something immediately. So I call it as a tender, and they're in the end. So trust me, you've got their attention.
Mission accomplished.
Good.
And they wake up every morning and read the construction management.
Good.
Survival.
We'll be talking about
the Ken's picture before they go to bed.
So anyway, you did a good job on that.
So this is a one of the multiples.
Yes.
So basically, if you only sell them the one piece, you're going to be responsible for the piece of dirt that they put on your side.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up too. So what they've also done, again, because they're a little panicked about everything, and I'll share these with you later because I got to tweak them, but they've given us a number of exhibits. Is temporary easements and or use agreements. For instance, we've got the Hall Road, so that's a temporary easement, if you will. They've got the use to come in and out of the site on Legacy Farms Road, again, not for a Hall Road, but you get a truck to work.
Yeah.
So they want one for that. We've got them building these parking areas, along the road, so they want an easement to be able to build those and maintain those. So that all the things that you see up here, that one easement's on, because they want all that look, they want to find out later, gee, we didn't do it right.
Good.
That's great.
Okay.
So we have two things that we requested that could get signed this evening. One is the two Mylars.
Let's go to that one first.
Yeah.
Okay. And Jennifer, that meets the A&R requirements, both in frontage and
yes.
Size. Entertain a motion to sign the
motion.
Seconded. Yep. Any further discussion?
Discussion, please.
Go ahead.
Naming on the
roads and everything is Wilson Street is Wilson Street.
That's but is that is that's not they haven't chosen those names.
They actually have submitted those to the select.
I think they're
going. No, not Lacey,
all the interior roads. I think
they're going before
the board
of selectmen.
They haven't approved that yet. Is that something we can sign? What if some of the names on it? You feed to it?
The Board of Selectmen make that decision.
Right. There's been a discussion.
But there's no street names on this.
Right. Legacy Farms Road.
Legacy Farms Road is set.
That's already.
That was set.
That's a subdivision road.
Okay.
Yeah, there are no other roads on here. This is purely a land plan. Nothing to do with it. You'll notice none of the developments on here. This is purely a subdivision of one parcel of land.
Legacy Farms.
No. But I thought the Legacy Farms Road North would be a different name.
No, what's going to be different is Rafferty Road was approved by the selectmen once this road opens to become Legacy Farms Road North.
So Rafferty Road is going to be a different name than Legacy Farms Road?
No, it will be Legacy Farms Road. Legacy Farms Road right now starts at Wilson Street.
Right.
It will continue across Wilson. Rafferty will become Legacy Farms Road North, all the way to 385.
We should have just talked Legacy Farms Road.
So we're going
to go. I wanted to try the department one to itself.
So on this lot here, it says Legacy Farms Road. That's Legacy Farms Road North. Is that incorrect or?
No, I think the north designation is just for the fire department of the north and south. Again, this has no bearing on this.
One more signing. First, it's an A&R.
I just want to be clear.
It's an A&R.
Sure. But if you don't sign it, we don't sign it. But I'm not saying sign it or not. I'm saying clarity. I'm a little just asking for a question here. Is Legacy Farm Road where describes where this is, where the lots are.
I don't remember us calling it north and south.
You didn't know
the subdivision plan.
But I think that's
what
the
Board of
Selectmen officially named Legacy Farm Road North and Legacy Farm Road South.
So does that make a difference for this?
No.
Thank you.
Okay. There's a motion in front of us to sign, endorse the A&R plan. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Necessarily probably. I think we're going to need two signatures.
Two signatures.
Which is one way. Motion to have the chairman sign the natural state restricted land covenant for parcel A1-1.
Second.
Third.
And you looked at these?
I haven't compared them with the print form versions in the master plan special permit and master plan.
So, we have motion in front of it to sign it. All further discussion, seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed, anyone abstained, motion carries.
That was the both of them, right?
Nope, this was one. The other one is a restricted land, which is a restored or landscape, which is a parcel A-1-1.
Gotcha.
Entertain a motion to sign that restricted land.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in further discussion, seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed, anyone abstained, motion carries. Why don't you talk a little bit about where we are on the roads and what your plans to bring them up to speed, and I think particularly on North, before construction begins, there's a bond requirement.
Yes, and we have gotten an estimate from Aggregate Industries on the potential paving. We have two estimates now on the landscape, and we're just waiting to have the third estimate tomorrow for line striping for the North Road. So once we have all those, we'll get those immediately. Obviously, we'll send it to Jennifer and she can share with you. And if you're in concurrence with those, we'll immediately get a bond for those.
So those will be the, we'll bring that up at our next meeting.
Yeah, I just received today a punch list for the North Road, and you saw that, so I knew probably so.
Yeah, that's actually going to be more on my level.
Okay, all right, I like
it. It's going to end up a little bit of a process of working on that.
Just sort of quick on that.
Ken, does that include the fog line as well? Did you mention the fog line?
There's a fog line.
Fog line on Rafferty's painted.
It is painted, yeah.
Actually, there's one couple little pieces missing. I got to pay those tomorrow. And DPW requested a minor change on grid 85. The line is like this, they want to put it for the back. So we're having that ground valve tomorrow morning.
So it's, but basically, we're looking for a bond, to finish. What will it take to finish all of including the punch list?
Yes.
Well, the punch list should be done. That's really under the category of level finishing a contract.
Before Colton can start, everything that isn't done has to be
on.
And I don't care whether it's a punch list with Ludlow or not.
I'll go with that with Ludlow tomorrow.
Maybe push them a little bit to get it done. Yeah.
For the viewing audience and people that maybe aren't really sure who Ludlow are, if they were the contractors that were developing, well, not developing, but doing the work on the upper farm area at.
They have the contract to build the North Road.
The Mass Works grant.
I mean, most of the things on the list, frankly, are pretty small stuff. I mean, if it was, $10,000 or $20,000, I'd be surprised. Other than those big piles of paper.
And the bridge.
The bridge is actually ours. That should be done by the 1st of October.
Okay. Will Ludlow have to finish the road at the end?
No, the finish code of the road is on us. And the landscaping is on us to finish that. And most of the things we're going to do.
They're on the punch list.
Trees, whatever it takes to bring it up to our subdivision plan.
Yeah, roughly 370,000 is the ballpark that it's across.
Whatever it is.
Yeah.
I mean, to get it close enough to data can look at. Because they're going to
have. We'll get the estimates.
I'll have those before the end of the week.
Okay.
I just want to make sure you're using this punch list from Beta. Where it says work by owner, it says install Franklin Road sign. It's really Franklin.
not Franklin. What's the reason why that or where?
Yeah, we told them that.
What's that?
There's a reason I actually have that sign at Grove Street not installed it yet. Because that's the rich name is Franklin, the Grove sign. And that's going to be a legacy also.
Above our pay grade. Okay, let's keep going. Where are you on the South Road? Are you planning to get any done this year or next year?
I was hoping there's quite a few dead trees and trees that just snuff up all the water in place. I've been purposely avoiding it this year because the drive is horrific. So we're hoping to go in there in the spring, replace any and all dead trees that are missing. There's a bunch of punch list things we want to get done. I'm also wanting Colton to get that wall, but running around and doing a road down there. So our goal is to upgrade the planting over there, get some punch list things out of the way. I want to go through the data to look at sort of what they can see as their punch list. And then what I'd like to do in the fall is get it paved for winter, so that in the next fall and spring, we get approved to town.
So we're looking at next summer for finishing up the south.
Yes.
So I think the work is supposed to be done by the end of October 2020.
Where does that say that?
The subdivision approval. She said that there was a time frame by which the work needed to be done, and that expires the end of October. So I'll confirm that with her. But
we'd probably say something like you've got to get it done
like
within
so
5 years or something. It's probably been about
so
5 years.
It's going to go,
yeah, I think so.
If it goes beyond that, we need to do an extension or something. And then just to
I don't
clarify,
think anyone on the board would have a problem extending it another.
Just to clarify, it's not, I don't know if it's Beta. I think it's Weston and Sampson that's doing the work over there.
Yeah, Weston and Sampson's here. Yeah, probably frankly be smarter to use them because they did the whole job.
I talked to John
rather
than
creating the wheel.
Right.
That's where I'm going.
That makes sense. So finish up. Okay. So we have pretty good status of where it is. North and south. Any other questions or members? I'd just like to talk just a second. I think Elaine did an analysis of where we are building permits.
Yeah, she said
you got it. Did other members of the board get that?
Everybody got it.
Yeah. Basically, of the 275 building permits for the multi-units, they have already issued building permits for 251. So they only have 24 that don't have any permits to go. And, you know, they're primarily right off of Clinton Street.
Yeah, they call that Village End. I'm told they'll be through with the sales on the south side probably in November. It's amazing.
So it's.
I think they sold 80 houses this year.
It's amazing, because I remember they wanted to be finishing this up and moving
the timing tomorrow.
Basically, there's only a duplex that's left, if I can remember.
Wow.
So that's, you know.
Have you taken a tour through the Hawthorne City looking at home?
I've seen the way it was for.
Okay, yeah, it's the same idea. That's all we have in the late September.
The manager has
where is that?
It's corner of Clifton.
And they're all rentals, correct?
Yes. You're in by the month.
Right.
Yeah, I think they're about 50%.
And you're still below the age of their average profile.
Yeah, their average profile.
But I get a letter from them.
75 to 90.
Yeah, their services seem amazing, though.
Yeah. It's if you're still kind of active, but you just don't want to cook, this is probably not a bad deal.
Right,
you
know, right now, the bed.
They say about 20% of people who have a car after 6 months is 10%.
I think say average age when they get a drop in bonus.
So which company built that?
It's called Hawthorne.
Okay. Morgan?
Yeah, they have stuff all over the
country. Absolutely. Best presentation to this board that I can make aware of all the board. I knew exactly what the questions were before everyone asked it.
It was great.
And he flew all the way to Portland to sign with the board for an hour. And he came here once.
It was a nice company.
I did made the presentations and really good. Obviously done it so many different times before. You know, it's great. And the place is pretty nice, actually. Just trying to talk to one or two of them. Anyway, okay. I think we're trying to get through a few more things. Thank you very much, Roy.
Thank you. Appreciate your time. We'll see you Saturday, the 24th. In the meantime, I'll mention the travel.
Yeah, front. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, right.
Entrance.
Okay.
Okay.
We have a bunch of things
to thanks, Roy.
Finish up on.
Thank you.
Zoning Advisory Committee appointments.
Yes, we have several in front of you tonight.
No. Well, let's talk about it first. Who from the planning board wants to be on?
I'd be happy to step up and do that again.
Brian Carp. Anyone else? Anyone else want to be on?
When do they meet?
Yes.
When do they meet? Typically the opposite Monday of planning board.
The opposite Monday of planning board.
So. Typically, I mean, can change. Depends on, you know, once we first meet.
Zach,
really based on what everybody can get together.
I'll do it for Zach, I guess. If nobody minds. Alright. Thanks. Appreciate it.
How many people do we need from planning board?
One or two.
No more than two.
Unless somebody doesn't, unless somebody objects.
How many people are we looking to have on the board?
I feel some tension down the other end of the room.
He asked me how many people. I said no more than two.
Okay. I can pass it off to somebody else if somebody else wants to do it. I'm just stepping up. That's
so
it.
Last year, I think you had like 15
we
or 16.
We started on 15, so
lot.
To 13, it was still a lot.
Right, and I think this year you decided it would be a good idea to somewhat limit it. Yeah. So,
9 to 11, I think.
So right now, if you were to approve everybody that expressed interest, you'd have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, plus 2 planning board members would be 9. So.
Okay, the nine people is Jim Cirillo from the CONCOM, Scott Richardson from Chamber of Commerce, Ted Barker Hook at large, who was on it, I think, last year. John Catino, who's obviously been on it and chaired it at large. John
Saviano
at large, I think he was on last year.
He was, he's also
I don't think he's
in.
Not this year?
No. Then we've asked, there's Sean
Morrow, who would be an at-large member of his first volunteer position.
He said he lives over on Rainbow Road, I think.
I forget now.
It's over, he bought Michael Graham's old house.
Okay. Oh, do you want to do it?
He's over on Franklin.
I think it might be fair.
I think it is fair.
And then Rhea McNamara, who was not on it last year, but has been on it in the past.
Yeah. So, and Rhea.
And then the zoning board would nominate a member of their meeting on September 14th. And they would ask that you just appoint.
We will appoint whoever the Board of Appeals would like to have on it.
Good enough.
So.
Yep. So I actually think it would be 10. I think I missed one, so it would be 10.
Okay, and we've got Cliff and Brian. So is that 10?
I think that ends up being 10.
Do we want to make it a number of people?
A tie. You get a lot of ties, Brian, on that?
Yeah. sometimes.
It can, I mean, with any even number, it can have something happen. It
can
has
back to the combined selectmen planning board meeting.
Yeah, I remember that fiasco.
Was there a third member of this board that would like to join?
Yeah, no, I'll just step down, Ken.
You're going to step down?
Yep.
Okay, now we have nine.
That was the shortest tenure ever.
No shit.
We'll find something else for you to do.
He didn't pass the dress code.
Looks good today.
He does. That's
he looks good today. He does.
The only other thing is, Elaine asked that you not accept any new interests after this point. Because last year you did that, you added people after the fact, and it just got really confusing because they already started their work and everything. So she would say that this is the board at this point.
Okay. Okay, so I entertain a motion to appoint all those people plus the representative of the Board of Appeals.
So move.
Second. Move second for the discussions, and then how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? Motion carries.
Abstain.
What?
Abstain.
Given that the hour is getting late, let's look for approval of minutes of the 25th of July, 2016.
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Hold on,
Dan. Were there any comments to this?
You said July 25th or August 8th?
July
25th. I believe I walked in at the beginning of the first vote, and I don't think I voted because I didn't know what you guys were talking about, so I probably abstained. I didn't say anything on Monday, July 25th. It's the approval not required for tomorrow, the hour of water fresh water.
Oh, that was water fresh water.
Just to be clear, I walked in, I probably didn't say anything aloud, or I was just sitting down and didn't know what you guys voted on.
Okay, so basically, so the motion in front of us is to approve it with that correction.
Yes, please.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? Motion carries. Okay, now consider August 8, 2016 minutes.
Motion to approve.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? Motion carries. Okay, so we've got the minutes approved. Since John isn't here, we'll defer on sidewalk. We're already pushing the witching hour, so let's continue the annual goals.
We'll have time in our next meeting.
I think we will too. We'll start talking about master plan at our next meeting, which is good. And I'd also like to say for the record, while we approved the elementary school building project plan, they have not submitted their record plans. And obviously, without the record plans, we cannot finalize the decision. And so we have not finalized the decision. Hopefully we'll get the plans this week, and hopefully then we will review the plans, and hopefully the plans reflect what we approved at the meeting. But basically, just for the record, it isn't us that's holding them up.
Now their deadline for what they need to do is end of this month.
And, you know, quite frankly, site plan approval.
Their deadline is site plan.
Right, to us.
And you know, it's going to take us more than a few days, maybe, to review the plans to make sure that they are correct. And then, technically, there's a appeal process that one would, if they were to start work before the appeal process ended, they're at risk. I don't know whether that's a big risk or not, but basically, I'm just making a point.
Here's the quote from the paper. Work will on the date on site will begin October 1st. That's an interview last day.
Let's start clearing trees.
Get your, yep, and then coordinating the schedules
the officials for groundbreaking.
Right, for the cement.
Okay, well, anyway, that's where we're at.
All right.
Look for a motion to adjourn. Thank you very much, everyone.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.
Just there, you just want to do that?
That's true.
That was a...